that, we will go into prayer and then we can get going. Dearly Father, we thank you that we could all gather here together, not just here, but online. We pray that this service will be glorifying to you. Lord, we pray that I will decrease and you will increase, and you will speak through me. It'll be your word spoken. And Lord, we pray that we can take that into our hearts and minds, and may it transform us, may it build us up, and may it grow us into maturity in our faith. Lord, we pray that your heart will be heard today, that your will be done, not just in our personal lives, but as a church. We pray that you will grow this church. We pray that you will grow us as believers, that we may accomplish your will. And Lord, before anything else we do, we pray that we can seek you first. And Lord, that we can honor you and glorify you in everything that we do. We pray this on your name. Amen. So we are in the third week of our One Another series. Oh, it went away. And the first 2 weeks, we talked about loving one another and then accepting one another. And loving one another, we saw in James chapter 13 that Jesus gives us a new command to love one another as he has loved us. And by this, we will be known as his disciples. And in accepting one another, in Romans 15:7, he tells us, accept one another then as Christ accepted you in order to bring praise to God. And those are the two verses so far that we've covered, and we covered more, but those are the two key verses that we've talked about so far. And the goal of this series is, again, to encourage our faith walk, encourage us to stretch our faith, and challenge us to be able to grow into maturity. Again, not just as individuals, but as a church. That when people walk through those doors, when they see us on the street, or meet us in work, or Walmart, wherever we may be, they will know that we are the chosen people of God because of how we love and accept one another. And one of the things that I felt God telling me this morning was also to relay an expectation. As we go through this series, and really any series or any sermon or any teaching, as a pastor, it's my expectation for this church, and this is true of myself as it is an expectation for the church, that we should be meditating on all of what God's word is telling us. What I may present or another speaker may present, that we are taking that into our hearts and minds and actively trying to make sure that we are bringing that into our life. And it is transforming us, not something that's just... I don't do feel-good sermons. I mean, I hope I have a good feel-good sermon, but I don't just want to have nice and fluff and send you on your way. I want to challenge you. I want to bring, firstly and foremost, Scripture into your lives. I don't want to just make you feel good and send you on your way. I want to challenge you to become more like Christ. And so that is an expectation I have on myself and for all of us. So as we go through this series, I hope that one another and how we do that for one another will continue to transform us and help us to grow in that mission. And again, I love this. I love the photo every time I see it, just because it's a mash of people, and we're all messy, and we all have our baggage, and we all have the things that we're trying to work through with God. But that's church. Again, my pastor and I have been so used to joke around that the church would be great if there were no people in it. But that's the church. That's really the point. It's like we're messy. We do fail. We get things wrong. We stumble and fall. But the point is to get back up and continue to seek after Jesus. I don't care how many times you struggle and fall. The point is always going after Jesus. That's the goal. Whatever we're going through. And so with that, today we're going to talk about something that feels a little bit more uncomfortable than love and acceptance. Those things are kind of easy to talk about in church because we talk about them all the time. But today is going to be a little bit more uncomfortable because we're going to start looking at a passage that starts to convict us in a few ways. And so with that, I also love how God works, because if you were in Bible study today, we went over this passage already in James chapter 5. And as we were going through it, I almost had to stop and be like, well, John just kind of gave the whole sermon because he's so good at doing Bible studies. So. No, don't apologize for that. God's working in you. You definitely teach what you have to teach. But I was just kind of like, well, everyone else gets to hear something different. Anyway, so a little background on James, the book of James. It is widely believed that this book is written by the brother of Jesus. James is writing primarily to Jewish Christians. And like I was talking about last week a little bit, there is a difference between Jewish Christians and Gentile Christians within the first century in the early church, because both were having their own personal struggles about things and how they were supposed to follow Jesus. And so the book of James, he really takes an emphasis on the vital parts of Christian faith and living. And I love the book of James because he doesn't mess around. He just goes straight to the point, and he doesn't really care about your pride in doing it. So James is a great book because it just is almost a bulletin point of a book telling you this is how you're supposed to act and live as a Christian. And so with that, we're going to just read James chapter 5, 13 through 18. Is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let them call on the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being, even as we are. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again, he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crops. My brothers and sisters, if one of you should wander from the truth, and someone should bring that person back, remember this. Whoever turns a sinner from error of their ways will save them from a death and cover over a multitude of sins. That's a bit of a long passage, and as John said earlier, there's a lot in that passage. And so we're going to go through that passage and really see what the scriptures are teaching us. Now, today the message is about confession and or confessing and praying for one another. And when we read about the idea of confessing to one another, I think that we all can collectively say we kind of cringe at that idea. I mean, none of us like to admit our failures and admit the things that we just would rather keep secret inside. But as Christians, we are called to confess and called to pray for one another. And the interesting thing is, every time I think about confession within the church, I always think, we're not supposed to be dealing with sin, right? I mean, we're Christians. I mean, we're children of God. We're born into his sonship, and we're adopted into his sonship. We don't struggle with sin, right?
What?
And the fact of the matter is, as long as we're on this side of heaven, we're always going to be struggling with sin. That is just the fact of the matter. And that's okay. It's okay to have the struggle, but what's not okay is to remain in sin and remain in the struggle. And it's our sinful nature that separates us from God, but it is always Jesus who overcomes that sinful nature. And that is why we need to be seeking after God and seeking after Jesus. And this passage hits on really four distinct areas that we're going to go through. Sin, prayer, healing, and confession. And to start us off, we're going to talk about sin, essentially defining it and really seeing what this passage is talking about when we have in regards to sin. First, let's just define who has sinned. Romans 3:23 makes it abundantly clear. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Everybody has sinned. Doesn't matter who you are, when you lived, what you do, everybody has sinned. Second, what is sin? Now, sin is defined in the Greek and Hebrew as missing the mark. Now, if you've been to church long enough, you've heard this probably numerous times. But it is a really great description of sin, because you can imagine an archer looking at a target, and his target is the mark, and sin is when you miss the mark. Now, the one exception I have to this analogy is, this kind of can give the idea that missing the mark only happens by accident, because you're still aiming at the target, but you fire and you miss. Because if there's a target 10 feet away and I have a bow and arrow now, I'm missing. I'm just saying. But far more often, I tend to see this analogy happen. There's the target, and it's just over there. Like, you just totally, instead of aiming at the target, you go somewhere else. Now, that's not to say that you can't miss the mark on accident. This is where a trap a lot of new believers come into. They just don't know the word. They don't know what Jesus is teaching. And that is where the church is meant to build them up, encourage them, and teach them. That's the point of the church, is to build each other up, to love one another, accept one another, and help them go to Jesus. And so sometimes, yes, we can miss the mark by accident. Other times, we just don't even aim at the target. And our target is always meant to be Jesus. No matter what it is, no matter what situation we're in, it is always Jesus. We are trying to become more like Christ, and often we miss the mark and we sin. And so, when we really think about sin, we have to understand that it permeates every area of our lives. It permeates every area of creation. It has totally destroyed God's perfect creation, and we cannot save ourselves from it. It's just sin. It's the nature of sin. It's our sinful nature. And this is why we have to choose Jesus. We have to choose God. We have to choose Him almost in every single moment. And the church is a messy place full of messy people. And when we really seek after God, a part of that, supporting one another, is confessing to one another. But if your fellow believers never know what you're going through, if you never share with them, if you never confess to them, if you never give any idea to anyone that you are struggling with a sin or are already in sin or whatever it may be, whether it's just a praise or a prayer request, if they don't know, they can't support you. And that's really our first point, is we are called to confess to one another. Now, I want to talk a little bit about this idea of confessing to one another. First, I want to essentially define what this idea of confessing is and what it looks like. Because a lot of times, I've seen people do this wrong, and sometimes I've even seen people really hurt one another, trying to confess to one another, but it ends up doing more harm than good. So this is something we really need to dig into and see the differences between unhealthy confession and healthy confession. So I've come up with a definition after a lot of reading and praying and looking towards other pastors and commentaries. This is the definition we're going to go with today. Confession is being freed from sin through the act of accountability and praise. Let me say that one more. Confession is being freed from sin through the acts of accountability and praise. One of the greatest times of my life for my spiritual walk was when I was a part of a accountability group. After high school, I got into my church's college group, and a friend invited me into an accountability group with our pastor. And that was when God really took my spiritual life to a whole nother level. In the accountability group, we would talk about the things that we struggled with. We would confess things. And what was always interesting to me was our pastor had an amazing gift of discernment. And so even when we tried to hide something, the Holy Spirit spoke to him and just brought it forth. And it was really annoying, actually. And there were times that I didn't even have to walk in or be in his office and tell him. I would walk in and he would tell me what I was dealing with. And it was actually kind of scary at times. As I'd walk in and my like downtrodden, like really dealing with this, and like, oh, you're dealing with that. Like, no, it's just scary. It kind of freaks you out when someone tells you what you're dealing with. But in that group, I also learned the differences between healthy and unhealthy confession to one another. So first, we're just going to go through unhealthy confession. And these are really important because obviously they're unhealthy, but obviously they also give us an understanding of what it looks like to have a healthy confession to one another. So first, confession is not about dumping all of your sins on one another. I really appreciate how another pastor put it. He said, confession is not about throwing up all your sins on someone else because you feel better, but the other person stinks. That really is a great analogy for it. So it's not about throwing up, it's not about dumping your sins on another person just so you feel better. Confession is also not meant to be impulsive. It needs to be well thought out of how and when you're going to confess to somebody, ideally after a lot of prayer. Confession also means that you don't just confess to anybody. I cannot tell you how many conversations I've had with someone when they had to come to my office or come to just me later on, and like, are so-and-so okay? It's like, why, what they tell you. And they told them things that they didn't need to know. Now, they were very much trying to do the Christian act of confession, but this should be done with trusted people. You just don't tell anybody who or what you're dealing with. Confession is not about condemnation. Condemnation is from the devil, period. It is not something that we were meant to do. And regardless if it's unhealthy or healthy confession, you're going to feel shame. But with unhealthy confession, shame comes through condemnation. Do you see that? Unhealthy confession results in condemnation and shame through that condemnation. Unhealthy confession also leads to frustration and added shame. Because if you're in an accountability group where all you do is you go and you confess and then you leave, all you're going to feel is frustration, and you're going to feel added shame because you're not actively moving past the sin that you are confessing. You're not actively working to get closer to God because you're just confessing how you're failing towards God. So it's added frustration and it's just added shame. And ultimately, something's going to break in that accountability group. Ideally, or actually, it's already broken. So unfortunately, those are the aspects of an unhealthy confession. So let's look at what is healthy confession. Confession at its core is about accountability. It's not about just making yourself feel better. It's not about just dumping your sins on one another. It's about accountability with one another. So that both of you can, or a group, can encourage and support one another to grow closer to Jesus and to shed off the sin that is trapping you. Our sins are meant to be confessed to trusted and safe people. First, you need to know that whoever you confess to is not going to go tell anybody. Second, they need to be trusted. You need to be able to trust the person that you are confessing to. One, they are not going to shame you through condemnation. They are going to help you. They are going to encourage you through your faith. And confession needs to be done wisely. It can't, again, be impulsive. It needs to be well thought out. And with that, you think about the people in your life who are trusted, who are encouraging your faith, and will keep you accountable. And they won't tell anybody, no matter who it is. Confession cannot cause harm to other people. I once heard a pastor talk about how he, when he first really heard a message about confession, he got convicted about all the people he may have hurt. And he went around confessing to people what he had done to them and asked for forgiveness. And he got like three people in, hurt all three before his mentor stopped him. It was like, you are doing this horribly wrong. You need to stop. So confession needs to be done in a loving manner, well thought out, and it can't cause harm to someone else. And ideally, the people that you are in your group confessing with you, or the other person that you're confessing to, both of you can pray and talk and figure out how you can do so, confess to one another, and reconcile with one another in a healthy, loving way. And as I said, you will feel shame when you confess your sins in a healthy group. But that shame is coming through the conviction of the Holy Spirit. And ultimately, healthy confession leads to freedom and praise. When I was in my accountability group, it was very odd to confess a sin that I was shameful of and the Holy Spirit was convicting me of, but then feel freedom from that sin. And then as an accountability group, we would praise God that what he was doing in our group, what he was doing in our lives, and that would again praise, not that we were praising ourselves, but we were able to rejoice with one another with the freedom that we were now having and the growth we were having in Jesus. And so those are the differences between healthy and unhealthy confession. And one thing, this is probably the most destructive thing that a Christian can do to their own selves when it comes to this idea of confession, is keep it a secret. It never goes well. It will twist and turn in you until something breaks. Proverbs 28:13 says, "He who conceals his sin does not prosper, but whoever confesses and renounces them finds mercy." That's an incredibly powerful verse. And I love it because of the very last word, mercy. You will find mercy when you confess. And in John 1:9, it says, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness." When we confess, we not only find mercy, we find forgiveness. And those are incredibly powerful because what else could you possibly want from God? It is amazing to see how an act of confession, an act of accountability and praise can lead to the freedom and praise of God that transforms your life. And this is why I think it's uncomfortable when we talk about this, because we're still talking about the idea of confessing our sins to one another. Nobody wants to do that. But the freedom that you get from it, the mercy and forgiveness that you get from it is amazing. And then on top of it, you will be purified from all unrighteousness. Now, I also want to make one thing clear. It's going to be awkward. It's going to be difficult. And it's going to take a dagger to your pride to confess to one another. But again, if you're doing it in a healthy way, you will be able to get freedom from the sin and the struggle. And you are able to praise God, not just with yourselves, but with the church in general. When people see your spiritual growth, they see that one thing that just is different. Now, you want to know one other thing that's awkward, uncomfortable, and takes a dagger to your pride? All of Scripture. Scripture is going to make you uncomfortable because it's reflecting your sin back at you. It's going to be awkward because it's reflecting your sin back at you. It's going to be uncomfortable because you're being convicted of it. And it's going to take a dagger to your pride because you realize you're not the center of the universe. And finally, one of the most important parts of confession is prayer. No matter what, it is always prayer. It's almost everything that comes back to prayer. And again, it's our greatest tool, it's our greatest weapon, and it is a direct line to God. And so, healthy confession also must have prayer. And that is our second point. We are called to confess to one another and pray for one another. The two can't go together, or can't go without one another. They have to be together. And so far we've talked about sin and confession, how healthy sin looks, how it's meant to be done, and how we are called to do that. That is what a part of the Christian walk is. And as someone who's been through an accountability group and really seen the transforming walk that God does through that, I encourage you to find some trusted and safe people that you can confess your sins and struggle with. But reality, again, confession is really about accountability for your Christian walk. I can tell you through personal experience, you won't grow closer to God by keeping it a secret. It will just lead to frustration and ultimately more sin and more struggle, and it just doesn't go well. The freedom that you find within this accountability through confession is an amazing thing. And then all of you get to sit down and really pray through that, that God will encourage your faith, that he will help shed you of that sin, and that you can get victory over that. So that's confession. And the next part that I want to talk about in this passage is healing. Again, when we look through James 5:13 through 18, there was a lot of mentions about healing in it. And we're going to quickly go through that again just to see it. If any one of you is in trouble, let him pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is any among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church and pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. I think we might just stop there. Prayer and healing are mentioned again a lot in this passage. And there are some very powerful and interesting verses in there. And a fellow pastor presented an idea to me that I thought was really powerful about this passage, because he was actually going through the book of James with us. And he made a simple statement about this passage. And he stated that this entire passage, verses 13 through 18, are about health. And as we look at that, it starts to be interesting in how we see that being played out. Now, our society has become very concerned with the idea of health, whether it be mental health, physical health, but often we don't talk really about the spiritual health side of it in our society. But all of them are tied together. You can't have one without the other. And another way to describe spiritual health in a medical term may be, for doctors and nurses and such, maybe morale. A person who has high morale throughout their healing tends to do better. A person who has just a lot of great loving family and friends around them, they can get some really high morale, get a lot of support. They tend to do better. And that's just really the case that we can see with health. There is the mental, there is the physical, and there is the spiritual side of it. And so with this, we're just going to go through a little list of things that this passage talks about. Because there's also something that's very interesting happening, because every time it says the word health, it tends to also have the word pray right with it. Pray if you are in trouble. Pray for those who are sick. Prayer offered in faith will heal the sick. Confess and pray for one another, and prayer of the righteous are powerful and effective. Elisha prayed, and really, in that short few verses, that's how many times just prayer is mentioned. So let's discuss this idea of health just in this passage, and how this entire passage is just about health. And so when you look at this, you can see verse 13, if you are in trouble, mental health. Verse 14, if you are sick, physical health. And verse 16, confess your sins, spiritual health. But what's also really interesting is that verse 13, if you are in trouble, pray. In verse 14, if you or someone is sick, pray. In verse 16, confess your sins and pray. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. Now, there's really no greater verse I can possibly give than Matthew 7:7. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened. I mean, that's straight from the Bible about prayer. And then Ephesians 6:18 says, and prayer in the Spirit and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and keep all and always keep on praying for all the saints. Now, I cannot overestimate and I will tell you how important prayer in your daily life is. We should be doing it morning, noon, and night, all day long. It's again, our most powerful tool and our most powerful weapon. And it's how we glorify God. It's how we grow closer to God. It's our direct line to God. When we confess our sins to one another, we are actively encouraging not only our own health, but our health around us. Now, there's parts of this passage I actually struggled with, not in its in studying it and its understanding, but I don't believe in watering down Scripture. I believe in tackling it head on, verse by verse. I believe in teaching it, and I believe it is the ultimate authority, and this is why I will never do anything otherwise. Scripture is our authority. It's the only thing we stand on, and it is the love of God shown through us. It is our word from God. And so that's what I will always be teaching, is the Scripture. And so with that, you might be wondering, okay, that where are you going with this, Pastor Stephen? That was kind of an interesting thing to say. And the part that I was struggling with is actually the healing part of this passage. Because I believe every single person has had the question, why are some people healed through prayer and some people aren't? You can see where my struggle might have came in through this. But again, I don't believe in skipping over difficult parts of Scripture just because they may be difficult. I've had friends and family who have struggled with health. I've known pastors who are fervent believers in God. I've had friends die who were believers. I knew one pastor who, I cannot tell you how much that man loved God, but had an enormous amount of health problems. And he had thousands of people praying for him. I know you're thinking, wow, this really got real. But again, this is the church. This is where these things are meant to be talked about. So through all my life, that has been a question. Like, why some and not others? And through all of my Scripture reading and through all of my sermons I've read and listened to from other pastors and commentaries and books and everything, here's my answer to why some and not others. I don't know. I'm not going to be a pastor that just tries to use a lot of words to try and mask what I don't know. I don't know. But here's what I have learned. God is good. God is an amazing God who sent his son Jesus to die on the cross our death. And I believe in healing. I believe God is the greatest healer, and I believe He is a loving God who sees every aspect of the situation, and particularly the aspects we can't see. And how one healing can do amazing things for faith in other believers. But I've also seen those who struggle with health, who are believers, have amazing faith, and it increases the faith of believers. I have watched miracles happen. I have watched family members seemingly come back from the dead when they were lost. I have seen people healed of cancer. I have seen people go from the depths of darkness into the light and be amazing, passionate people. I have seen people healed of addiction through prayer. But I've also seen amazing faith in people who go through struggle. We serve a good and mighty God, and I still don't know the answer. And ultimately, I probably never will, until I get to heaven and God is there and I get to glorify Him and see everything that was going on. And I still believe and I still have faith that God is in control. It's difficult. Sometimes it feels impossible. But faith is what brings us through. This is why there's an expectation to grow. This is why we try to become more like Christ. I was at my lowest 2 years ago, and God brought me through that. And I wasn't dealing with health problems. Mostly it was just my pride that was taking over. But God still brought me through. My faith is my own, and I shouldn't expect anyone else to take my word for granted. This is why I expect all of us to dig into the Word, to really dig into our faith, that it's not just a thing you come to on Sunday morning or on Wednesday night. It is an active part of your day where you are actively growing your relationship with Jesus Christ. That your faith grows to where people look at you and they see something different that goes beyond understanding. To when the struggle does come, the person at work asks, like, why are you always in a good mood? And you can fervently and passionately, with a grin on your face, say, Jesus. I'm totally off my sermon, by the way. This is all God. So if I'm pausing for a number of things, it's because God's really trying to tell me something. This is also why confession is so important. We can see health problems progressing in people. We can see the physical declining. We can see mental health declining. But we can't see spiritual health declining unless we are being right with God in prayer. And we can't see that in others unless we are right with God. And this is why confession is so important. This is why prayer is so important. And finally, our final point is we are called to confess to one another. We are called to pray for one another. And we must seek after God's righteousness and holiness. Ephesians 4:24 says, and put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Now, being off my sermon, I'm just going to paraphrase my last part. When we can choose to follow Jesus, to make that choice to be a follower of him, to have faith in him. We can choose to follow him at every moment of the day. Our sinful nature will always be with us as long as we're on this side of heaven. But that doesn't mean we have to be slaves to it. We are not slaves to sin, those of us who have chosen to be with God as our Lord and Savior. In fact, Scripture says we are slaves to righteousness. And so, with that, you can choose Jesus in every single moment. Because the Christian walk, following Jesus, it comes down to only really one choice. Are you going to choose God, or are you going to choose yourself? Are you going to choose to follow Jesus in every situation, through every decision, through everything that he is calling you to do? Or are you going to choose him? And when you really meditate on that question, you really start applying it to your faith, you start seeing that question everywhere. Am I going to the movie to watch this movie? Is it glorifying God or not? Or am I going to get enjoyment? It's a simple example, but simple decisions also make up our spiritual life. You're called to a righteous life, a holy life. This is actually one of the core principles of the Church of God, is holiness, to live a holy life. John 2:28 and 29 says, Now, dear children, continue in him so that when he appears, we may be confident and unashamed before him at his coming. If you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone who does what is right has been born in him. The word righteous in the English dictionary says something to the akin of having right morals or being justified. And by that simple definition, God's righteousness means we take upon his moral law upon ourselves, that it is what we will live by. And holiness is similar in that we are taking on God's holiness, not that we become holy, but God's holiness is in us. Which means you can choose not to sin. Now, Pastor Stephen, are you saying that if I'm a Christian, I will never sin again? No. Sorry. You're going to struggle with that the rest of your life. Are you saying that if I just choose God's holiness, I will be holy and righteous? No. You have to choose God's holiness and righteousness, sometimes by the minute. I once heard a very interesting definition of leadership, and it's that leadership is making small, right decisions consistently until a big decision comes and you know what to do. Faith is similar in that faith has to be small choices related to God, that you are choosing him in the small decisions, so when the big thing comes, the big struggle comes, you know what to do. And a part of the small decisions is studying the word, getting into prayer, a prayer life, confessing to one another, praying for one another. And in 2 Corinthians 7:1 says, therefore, since we have these promises, dear friends, let us purify ourselves from everything that contaminates body, spirit, perfect holiness out of reverence to God. My friends, we are called. righteousness and holiness. We are called to confess to one another. We are called to love one another. We are called to accept one another. I want, as a pastor, to lead you towards that, not through my own strength, but through Jesus. Not through my own works, but through Jesus. I want all of us together to grow closer to God, because He is our ultimate hope, and He is the thing that saves us through His Son, Jesus Christ. I want to see people being honest about their struggle. I want to see people come through the door knowing that regardless of what's going on in life, they will be loved and accepted, and there's no condemnation here. That the Holy Spirit is here, and we are His disciples. And so with this, I'll just leave you with our main points today. We are called to confess to one another. We are called to pray for one another. And we must seek after God's righteousness and holiness. And again, for all of us, the expectation is that this is an active time where we go about our day. You just don't leave and that's it. You do it daily. This is an active thing we must do as believers. So with confession to one another, I would say pray and find the people who you can trust and are safe that you can confess with, and that it is a goal of accountability in order to get freedom from sin and praise God. With prayer, I hope you're having a prayer life every single day and praying with one another, praying for the church, praying for all the requests on the prayer sheet. And it's my fervent prayer and hope that you meditate on the choices towards God, not yourselves. I actually got to a point where every time that question popped in my head, it was really annoying because I could see where my sinful nature was trying to pull me. But then it hit me, like, now I have like a barometer in my heart because of the Holy Spirit, knowing when I'm choosing to sin. And it's really, really annoying to realize when you're choosing sin, because then the conviction is real. But it is something that I would not change for the world, and I hope and pray that these messages resonate with you and that it was God speaking, because I apparently my words didn't matter. But that is my hope and prayer for not just myself, but for all of you as a church, that we can reach the lost because of how we treat one another through Scripture. Let's pray. Dearly Father, we thank you so much for your Son Jesus, first and foremost. We thank you for the love that you have for us. We thank you that you are faithful. And we praise your name for the good and mighty God that you are. Lord, we may not have all the answers, but you do. And that's why we seek after you. Lord, we pray that as a body of believers, we can find those that are safe and trust in to confess to one another, that we can pray for one another, and that we can always seek after your holiness and righteousness, that those will be the defining characteristics of our heart, that we love you, and we seek after your holiness and righteousness, and we honor your word by being obedient. Lord, I pray that you will bless everyone as they go about their week, keep them safe. I pray that the Holy Spirit will fill all of them, all of us, and help us to grow closer to you and hear you speak to us this week. We pray this all in your heavenly name. Amen.